you remember this little tank car that I built a month or so back? Oh, I asked at the end of the video if anybody wanted to see me give it a bit of a weathering. And to my surprise, several people said, of course we do. So, this is that. To assist with this project, we have Cobblestone Nitro Stout by Mill Street Brewing from Toronto. It's a nitrogen-charged stout, so it's got a pretty significant head on it. And, but I had a little bit of a taste out of it, and it's just a nice oaty stout. Kind of dark, kind of roasty malty like you'd expect. And it's organic for those who are concerned about such things. But while the head's taming itself down a little bit, might as well do a little bit of research. Because black freight cars are really hard to do weathering on. More traditional colored cars, browns and whatnot, oxide colors. You know, cars like these, they're relatively easy, well, easier to weather because you add dirt, right? And similar to the wood deck on this flat car, the car itself didn't show very much, but the deck itself, just added some scrapes to the wood and added some mud and whatnot and call it a day for a fairly simple weathering job. But for a black car, adding dirt doesn't do anything. And it'll darken up the lettering and stuff, so I suppose we could do some of that. But what do you do to make it look as old as this one is or would be in the 1970s when my model railroad is set? After all, this car was built in 1928, according to its stencil. So in the 1970s, when my railroad is set, this car would be on its last legs. Actually, in the real world, it probably would be in the scrapyard by then. But in my world, it's on its last legs, so it's going to look kind of grubby. It's probably going to be some rust and stuff. But I think probably the first thing to do is go and see if I can find some photos of old tank cars. So here's some pictures that I found. These are a more modern car, but it doesn't matter. You see that they've gone a little bit lighter, actually. They've gone a bit gray. That one looks like it's also gotten a little bit lighter, maybe from dust, maybe some dirt and grime off the road or something. There's a little bit of rust on the trucks and on the faces of the wheel, not on the treads though, because the treads are obviously going to be shiny. This old timer, you can see a lot of streaking of white or light gray coming down the sides, so that's interesting. That's actually a similar vintage to the one that we're playing with, so that's useful. And again, there's a bit of rust on the axles and stuff. This old guy, again, we got some light colors on it. And again, that's a very similar vintage to the car that we're looking at. And judging by the people visiting, it's in static display, obviously. But judging by the dress of the people visiting, it's pretty well aged. Down on the bottom here, below that rivet line, there's even more streaking and possibly even bits of rust in there. So that's interesting. And again, another one that's gotten lighter. There's some splash here from mud. And there's some streaking from stuff coming down. Now, the car that I've got on my workbench carried oil. This car that we're looking at right now looks like it was probably carrying something lighter colored. But even after I lighten the car, I can probably put some streaks of something shiny black down the side. Maybe a drip of ink or something. Who knows? That overexposed picture of another old car. And again, it's gone light and gone lighter. So maybe add some gray or something. And another one, with these black and white pictures, it's hard to tell. And this guy, again, streaking. So I think that's probably what we're going to try and do. I don't know if I'm going to be able to succeed. This one looks like it's even, similar age. It's 1937 vintage thing. So we're going to need a few supplies. So as usual, I'm going to use just cheap craft store, dollar store acrylic paints in an assortment of colors. I'll just pull these all out here. So we got some black, red iron oxide, burnt umber, earth brown, brown iron oxide. So those guys will be rusts and dirt. Got a couple of different grays over here. We got another brown. Is that the same brown as that one? Yeah, a little bit different. Got some white and black. So these guys will make our grays for streaking. I've also got raw sienna ink, which will probably run pretty well. And I've got a translucent black ink, which may work for drips of oil, possibly, who knows. So other supplies that we're gonna need, an assortment of paint brushes. For weathering, you don't need necessarily precision brushes, although maybe one a little bit smaller to throw in some rust here and there, but mostly we want the streakiness that you get from a cheap crappy brush. Of course, some paper towels because this will get messy. Some toothpicks just for paint stirring. And some kind of little mixing cups because we're going to be using this paint fairly wet as washes generally. There might be some dry brushing too, I don't know. Weathering is, for me anyway, weathering is always pretty experimental. So there I've got a little bit of red iron oxide and a little bit over here and a little bit of brown iron oxide there. Let's turn them into some light washes and see what happens. Maybe mix them. Yeah, what happens when I mix them? Not too much though. I kind of want it splotchy. And we'll see where we can. We'll put some rust on the trucks, on the truck side frames here. That'll be good. Now, remembering that at the end of this weathering, I'm going to hit the whole thing with some dull coat, which will kind of fade and mute all of the colors that I've done here. So if it looks a little bit carried away at the beginning, I'm not too bothered. And precision isn't necessarily a part of this, except for you don't want, paint on the treads of the wheels and stuff like that. But that's purely for functional reasons, not for decorative reasons. Just kind of slopping some paint on here, wet and runny. Let it drop into the crevices and stuff. And then dab the brush off a little bit and just pick up any puddles and stuff. But try and leave some behind in the low spots. Sort of a balancing act, but just make it look right. Now then, I think I wanted some on the faces of the wheels here. Just get it in there and dry the brush off again and just pick up any. Let's get some in there. And then dry off the brush, then pick up the excess. I got some on the tread. Deal with that later. So where else are we going to find rust on this thing? Maybe down the brake rigging a little bit. But not too much. Maybe around the coupler, because the couplers are never painted. But again, not too much. I'm thinking I'm going to throw some just along this entire horizontal beam, and anything that's horizontal where water would sit. I think that makes sense. Okay, I think that's it for rust for the moment. Wonder what happens if I put a little bit of this translucent ink, just drizzle it over the lettering. Make it vertically streaky too. Because we saw in a lot of those prototype photos, a lot of vertical streakiness, right? That sort of dulls down the lettering a little bit. And on the placard as well. Ooh, it's a little heavy on the placard. Because those things would be changed regularly. And definitely that down there, that lettering down there. Okay, I'll do a bit of that on the other side too. I'm going to have more happening over here, but this is a start anyway. Mustn't forget about the lettering on the ends. Getting under those guardrails and handrails is hard. Okay, so now I'm just going to mix up a kind of a gray wash. Handy little water bottle here. I use it to wet down the sponge of my soldering station a lot too. So I want this super, super thin because I want most of it again to just run right off. We'll see what happens. Actually, let's just see what happens anyway if I rain on it. That's interesting. Try and pick some of this up off the side sills here because I don't want that there. Like I said, this is very experimental, so it could go horribly wrong. It's one of the reasons that I like using water-based stuff for weathering, though, is that you can always rinse it off and start over again, especially on a plastic model. On a wooden model, not so much, right? Now, I know I'm going to have to clean my trucks and clean my wheels when I'm done with this. I've just resign myself to that. Okay, so I've let the that dry for a little bit. There's still a little bit of moisture on there, but not too much. Now I think I'm going to try maybe a little bit of dry brushing with the gray just to get some better vertical streaks, because I'm not sure how well that's worked. So for dry brushing, basically you pick up just a little bit of paint and you kind of swipe it around on your paper towel until it's 90% gone. And you just lightly streak it on there. That's even... No, don't like that. Get some wet brush action going. But I might as well just kind of scrub that out a little bit and then go back vertical on it. Try some down here. And again, that's a little bit much. So I'll just use this slightly damp cleaner brush and try and make this, try and rub it out as much as I can, but do it in vertical motions. There's enough moisture on that paper towel just from cleaning my other brushes that I can pick up water off it. Maybe that'll look okay. You know, try a little bit more on this side. I'm a little bit concerned that I've got sort of drippy looks on the side there, so I'm just going to keep vertically streaking it here. So I mentioned earlier that if I get a little bit too much on there, I'm not super concerned. It's an old car, plus the dull coat that I put on at the end to fix everything in place is going to sort of calm it down a little bit. So one thing that I've noticed has happened as as I was doing all that wet stuff, is it's kind of rinsed my ink off the lettering, and it's kind of made it pop out again, which is not what I wanted. Yeah, that's better. Some of those might not even be completely visible, which is exactly what I want. Okay. More drying time. Okay, so that's pretty much dried. And off camera, I spent a little bit more time just fiddling around. And it looks, kind of streaky, kind of not too bad. It's not the best work that I've ever done, but I think I'll go with it for now. So that means it's time for Dull Coat, which is a clear matte finished lacquer spray. And since I'm going to be spraying, that means I have to deploy the spray booth of jankiness, which I can't really get all on camera here. All right, let's get to it. Yep, there you go. Just zoom in a little bit so you can just give it a good wetting. And the reason I've got it sitting up on these, partly to get wet the paint blow underneath a little bit, but mostly so that I've got a handle. Eek. Close enough. You know what? Once again, I've screwed up. I forgot to mask off the couplers, because this stuff can glue the couplers shut if you're not careful. And, oh well. Well, I guess I'll just deal with that when the time comes. We'll let some time pass and see what happens. Okay, today is tomorrow, and this is dried overnight. It looks a little bit grubby and weathered. You can see some of the streaking and staining on that side. That's kind of neat. Spin them around here. And again, looks like there's some streaking and stuff there. Now, the car numbers didn't come out quite as darkened or discolored as I'd hoped. The rust on the truck side frames is fairly pronounced. Maybe a little bit too much, but that's okay. Looks like I got away with it. Yep, I didn't glue the trucks together, or the couplers together with the dull coat. That's excellent. So the only thing really left to do is to clean up any paint that's slopped onto the wheel treads. And that's just fairly easily done with a bit of alcohol and a generic, not Q-tip, Q-tip kind of thing. That comes off fairly clean. You want to give your wheel treads a scrub now and again anyway. So I'll just go through this with each one. So this, this little bottle here I got off eBay, like so many of the things that I'm using, it's just, chemical lab bottle or something. But it works really good for alcohol. And I know a lot of guys use isopropyl. I am using 99.9% methyl hydrate or methyl alcohol. It's often sold in the paint department of hardware stores or in as camp fuel for certain types of stoves as well. And as usual, I just take whichever source I can get cheapest. But you want something that's 99.9% pure. You don't want the 70% stuff, because that other 30% in alcohols is often oils and things like that. And that's kind of the opposite of what you want when you're cleaning. And there we go, all put back together. I think that turned out fairly well. I was being a little bit shy. I didn't want to overdo it. But as I said before, and as we've seen in previous attempts at weathering, that dull coat really subtles out what you've done. And you can do this multiple times. The fact that the dull coat's on there doesn't mean you can't just put another layer of weathering on. And using water-based weathering methods like I tend to use, if you think you've gone too far before you dull coat it, you can just wipe it off or rinse it off with more water. I hope that was interesting or informative or entertaining or something for you. I know a few people asked to see what weathering looked like on a car like this. So since I was doing it anyway, bring you along as usual. If you've got anything to say about it, jump down into the comments as usual. I always like to hear from you guys down there. And like I said many times, with any of my projects, the way I do it is not the only way to do it. It might not even be the best way to do it, but it's how I did it. There's lots of other weathering videos to give you other ideas from other people on YouTube. Feel free, if you got a favorite technique, especially for these black cars that are hard to weather anyway, please link it in down below. Thanks for watching, everybody. I will talk to you later.